song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy. Your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like worship Your holy name. Bless You, Lord. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Come on, bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Yes, I will worship Your holy name. Lord, I worship Your holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. Worship Your holy name, Jesus, I will worship Your holy name, worship Your holy
Hey, good morning. My name is Nate Brewster, and while Barry's inside, I just wanted to let you all know, all kids, listen up. I stole Barry's hat. You know the one he's been wearing the last few weeks for services? All right, so I've stolen that, and I've hidden it, but I need you guys to keep it a secret, okay? And if you guys are quiet and you don't tell anybody, then I've got a few cookies for all of you after the service, all right? So don't tell anybody that it happened, but I've taken his hat and I've hidden it. All right, thanks, guys. Have a good service.
Well, good morning. How is everyone this morning? Honk your horns, wave, whatever. Yeah, there we go. Yeah, so this morning we're going to start off with some worship. And I would encourage you, if you have not downloaded our church app yet, to go ahead and take a moment and do that. Open up the App Store or Google Play and search for Core Christian Community. It's conveniently written on our building right here. But search for Core Christian Community, and after you download that, go ahead and open it up. I will show you how you can follow along with today's worship songs and sing in your car, or if you're standing outside, sing outside. So the way to get there is after you open up the app, go to Meridian Point Church. That's the name of the church that meets here at the community center. So tap on Meridian Point Church. And then after you tap on that, go to Sunday. After you tap on Sunday, you will see the section called Worship. And when you tap on Worship, you'll be able to see the songs that we're doing. Beneath the waters, so will I, and from whom all blessings flow. And so I want to show you real quick, though, how to get back out to the next song as well. So go ahead and tap on the first one, Beneath the Waters. Okay, you'll see all the lyrics. Up at the top left, you'll see a back arrow. And that's how you get back out to the menu. So if you tap that back button, you'll be able to get to the other songs too. All right, so today as we worship, make sure to sing loud in your cars. Let's lift up the Lord together today. Let's pray together before we get started. Father, we thank you for good weather. Father, it's absolutely gorgeous day. We just pray, Lord, today that we lift up your name. God, that you be lifted high, that your name be praised above everything else. Father, I pray that our hearts and our minds will be ready to receive your word. And God, that you will teach us and show us more of who you are and draw us closer to you as we draw near to you. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, let's sing. This is my revelation, Christ Jesus crucified. Salvation through repentance at the cross on which he died. Now hear my absolution. Forgiveness for my sin. And I sink beneath the waters that Christ was buried in. I will rise, I will rise as Christ was raised to life. Now in him I live. I stand a new creation, baptized in blood and fire. No fear of condemnation, by faith I'm justified. I will rise, I will rise, as Christ was raised to life. Now in him, now in him. My life confess your lordship and glory. glorify your name. Your word, it stands eternal. Your kingdom knows no end. Your praise goes on forever and on again. No power can stand against you. No curse assault your throne. No one can steal your glory, for it is yours alone. I stand to sing your praises. I stand to testify. For I was dead in my sin. Now I rise. I will rise. Come on. As Christ was raised to life, now in Him, now in Him, I live. I will rise, as Christ was raised to life. Now in Him, now in Him, I live. I will rise, as Christ was raised to life, now in Him. We're going to go back out to the menu and sing, So Will I.
God of creation, there at the start, before the beginning of time, point of reference, you spoke in the dark and fleshed out the wonder of light. And as you speak, 100 billion galaxies are born in the vapor of your breath, the planets form. If the stars were made to worship, so will I. I can see your heart in everything you made. Every burning star, a signal fire of grace. Your creation sings your praises, so will I. God of your promise, you don't speak in vain, no syllable empty or void. You have spoken, all nature and science follow the sound of your voice. And as you speak, 100 billion creatures catch the breath, moving in pursuit of what. If it all reveals your nature, so will I. I can see your heart in everything you say. every painted sky a canvas of your grace. If creation still obeys you, so will I. So will I. Stars were made to worship, so will I. If the mountains bow in reverence, so will I. If the oceans roar your greatness, so will I. For if everything exists to lift you high, so will I. Where you send it, so will I. If the rocks cry out in silence, so will I. The sum of all our praises still falls shy. Then we'll sing again 100 billion times.
Up your name and your name alone today. As the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords that you are, may our lives scream your praise. What gift of love could I offer to a king? What weight or worth could be held within my offering? When he alone is worthy, a glory song is inscribed upon my heart.
this treasure held in an alabaster jar. I break when he alone is worthy. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. What sacrifice could be equal to His own? The cross of Christ has declared that there is not I owe. Yet I from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. The living Christ, the servant Son, the prophesied, the saving One, the Holy Ghost sent from above, the faithful friend, the seal of love, this life, this heart. Song to Him, my all in all, my everything. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above you.
Good morning again. Want to thank you for coming out this morning. Want to say hello to all those that are online. Glad you are with us this morning. Several people got to thank. Want to thank our safety guys that have been parking everybody, getting everybody in here, making sure everything goes well. So if you, yeah, either a round of applause or horn honking for our guys out there. So. Also, want to thank all those that have been involved in our little outdoor cafe and our communion preparation and all that. That takes a lot of work, too. So if you can thank them, they've done a great job. For our band that's coming out every morning and leading us in worship, so appreciate that. Nate getting all that ready. And finally, for our Scheffler production company, who has been putting all of our sound and FM transmissions and online stuff together, they have almost been able to make us look professional. And that is tough. No amount of technology can completely pull that off, but we're glad they've been doing that for us. We are going to take, yes, we're going to take a little bit of a break from our Wash Hands, Talk About Jesus messages. We'll continue that next week with the things that Jesus taught. We're going to continue with our family series. So if you've been, how many of you got kids K through fifth grade with you here today? Honk your horn. All right, good. How many of you just left them at home on their own? All right, yeah, that's what I figured, all right? So we want to, we're going to continue in that series, and we have been talking about being good biblical detectives in our family series. We've been studying a book called Cold Case Christianity for Kids. And so one of the things we're going to do is we're going to wrap up that series today. Today is the last in that series. We'll start a new family series next month, but we're going to wrap up our series on detective school. Let me ask, is the food truck out there yet? I can't see around the corner. All right, so here's what we're going to do. Because our lines can get long over there, if you want to go give them your order and all while I'm preaching, perfectly okay. Anything to keep you awake, so be more than willing to let you go over. So if you'd like to do that, when you see there's not somebody over there and you're going to be staying for lunch and you want to make an order, feel free to do that. We're going to wrap up our detective series today, and my son is making a sprint for the food truck. So, all right, so we're going to be wrapping up our detective school today. We've been focusing on learning detective skills that will allow us to investigate the Bible and its claims, and specifically the claims about Jesus and his resurrection. And our kind of big lesson from this series has been this. God wants us to love him with our minds. God wants us to love him with our minds. Take a look at Matthew chapter 22. Verse 37, and we'll do what we've been doing. When you find that, if you'd honk your horn for me, that lets me know you're still with me. And there we go. Or yell honk for those of you that are sitting outside. All right. So here's what Jesus said. Jesus is repeating something that was said in Deuteronomy, but here's what he said. Jesus replied, "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind." Too often, we can focus in very much on that idea of loving God with our hearts and our souls, but sometimes we leave the mind part out of things. Too often, we see faith as purely a feeling thing and not necessarily a thinking thing. But the Bible says faith needs to be both of those, that God has given us both a heart and a brain, and our feelings cannot be left to themselves. They must be informed by our minds, and our minds need to be prompted by our feelings. They must never work completely independent of each other. It is okay to question God, to ask him questions, it really is, to examine the case that he has laid out before us. It is good to be skeptical and curious, a detective when it comes to things of God. God desires us to love him with our mind and to check things out. Take a look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. When you find it, go ahead and honk. Verses 19 through 21. That was a really weak out loud honk from some. Honk. All right, so here we go. 1 Thessalonians 5, 19 through 21. Do not stifle the Holy Spirit. Do not scoff at prophecies, but test everything that is said. Hold on to what is good. Stay away from every kind of evil. Then take a look at Acts 17:11. Honk when you get there. It says this, and the people of Berea were more open-minded than those in Thessalonica, and they listened eagerly to Paul's message. They searched the scriptures day after day to see if Paul and Silas were teaching them the truth. See, I think everyone, and especially Christians, need to be encouraged to use your minds, to love God with our minds. And as we see in our current situation in the world today, we live in a world where we have so much information that we often just accept what we see because we either won't take time to think hard about the subjects or we haven't been taught how to think about and process information. We are not used to anymore thinking deeply with our minds. But God has said, I want you to love me with your mind. And that means as much as you pour your heart and soul into loving God, we need to be engaging our minds in loving God. And so before we get to our last topic for detective school, I want to review some of the skills we've been learning as detectives. The first skill we developed was don't make assumptions. Don't make assumptions. An assumption is something we think we know that isn't based on evidence. If we're going to be good biblical detectives, we need to limit our assumptions. We need to have open minds and examine the evidence before we start assuming things. If you remember way back when we talked about this subject, I asked people if they thought I could juggle. And a bunch of people said yes, and a bunch of people said no. And so I said, okay, here I go, and I dropped them all. And I said, now how many of you think I can juggle? And most people didn't raise their hand, and there were a few people that said, no. I've seen him juggle before. I know he can do it. He's trying to fool us. They didn't assume certain things. And eventually I did juggle, and you learned that I can juggle. See, we found that a lot of people assume things about God and the Bible, but they haven't checked out the evidence very well. God says, if you want to love me with your mind, think about the evidence. Check it out. Think it through. So number one for our detective skills was don't make assumptions. Try to limit your assumptions. Skill number two was this. We have to be able to infer well. Inferring is the ability to make good conclusions based on the evidence we have. If you were here, I brought a thing called a dice tower with me. And I asked a bunch of kids to come up front to the stage. Remember the stage? This was this thing way back when we had where people stood in a building and talked. Okay? So I brought a thing called a dice tower. And I had the kids try to infer from what they could find out about it and about me what a dice tower was for. And if you remember, if they were here first service, honk if you remember the kids that found the label on it that said exactly what it was. All right? It was terrible. They did really good inferring that the label told you what it was. Other kids, when I took the label off second service, they had to try to figure out from the different clues I gave, what is this thing used for? They were inferring things. The whole universe is filled with evidence and objects for us to make some inferences about. And the Bible says if we check out the evidence, it will point to God. If we make good inferences, we can find God. We can find the evidence that says he is real and true. We showed how good inferences show us that there is very reasonable evidence of God and the truth of the Bible and that Jesus is exactly who he claims to be. The third skill we learned was to think circumstantially. Kind of a big word, but we talked about two kinds of evidence. The first kind of evidence is called direct evidence. That is, an eyewitness is called direct evidence. I saw it happen. That's direct evidence. But the second kind of evidence, where there's usually a lot more of, is called circumstantial evidence. That is all other evidence that is not an eyewitness. That would be writings and fingerprints and tire tracks. Neither direct or circumstantial evidence is better, but they complement each other. How many of you like detective shows? I love detective shows. I think I've seen every single one of the Forensic Files shows. Love those things. And here's what you find out. Most cold cases are solved with only circumstantial evidence. They don't have a living eyewitness anymore who can tell you directly what happened. It's all circumstantial. So it is important to see how circumstantial evidence works when we deal with things from the past when we don't have a direct witness. See, you don't need direct witnesses to prove things are true. And we discussed how the circumstantial evidence for the truth of Jesus is overwhelming. It's overwhelming. The fourth skill that we learned was testing our witnesses. If you remember, we had three people come up to the stage. That's that thing again, that weird thing that's in this building, all right? They came up to the stage, and the three people sat there, and the kids had to try to figure out one of these person was telling the truth, and two of them were going to be lying to you. And you had to interrogate the witnesses and try to find out who's telling you the truth. And we learned four things that we have to ask witnesses to find out if we can trust them. We have to know, were they really where they said they were, to have evidence about what they're talking about. We said, can we verify what they say? Is there other evidence that verifies what they're saying? We ask, have they changed their stories over time? Or have they been consistent? And finally, we said, do they have a good reason to lie to us? We discussed how good our Bible witnesses are. Our Bible witnesses meet all those standards, and so we can trust their eyewitness testimonies. Finally, we talked about skill number 5, and that was separating artifacts from evidence. That was one of our first drive-in services. We talked about this. We talked about how detectives have to tell what items at a crime scene deal with and are important to the crime, and what ones have really nothing to do with the crime itself. And so if you can imagine, a detective shows up at a crime scene and there's medical stuff all over the place, but they know that the EMTs were there trying to help the victim. They would know that all the medical stuff is an artifact. It doesn't have anything to do with the evidence for the crime. It was added later on. So what we find is the Bible has a few things that looks like it's changed in it. We talked about some missing verses, or we talked about some different sentences, but we were able to compare those relatively few things to the thousands of copies of the Bible we have to determine what the original writing said, and we can see if anything has changed from the original evidence. And so by separating out artifacts from evidence, we find our current copies of the Bible are getting more and more accurate all the time. We can have great confidence that the copies we have now are what the original evidence really was. We're taking the artifacts out. So as we've learned, all these detective skills we find, there is an extremely good case for believing there is a God, that the Bible is true and accurate, and that Jesus was real and he was who he said he was. That's where our detective skills lead us. But today I want to ask this. What if it's just not true? What if it's just not true? Maybe the disciples, maybe they all conspired to just tell this story and fake their testimonies and fake their writings. What if it's all a conspiracy that they made up? What if it was a trick to make us believe all this, but it really wasn't true? Well, first realize this. You can doubt anything. You can doubt that Abraham Lincoln really lived. You can doubt that your teacher is a human. You could say maybe she's an alien. And now that you're all homeschooled, you might be thinking that about your parents, all right? Maybe they're aliens. Maybe they're not really human. You can doubt that vegetables are good for you. So our question can never be, can you doubt things? The answer is yes, you can doubt anything. The real question is, can you reasonably doubt some things? So with all of the circumstantial evidence we have, it is not reasonable to doubt that Abraham Lincoln never lived. The circumstantial evidence says he lived. It is probably not reasonable to think that your parents are aliens and not humans. The evidence pretty much says they're human, all right? And there is, like it or not, good evidence to reasonably believe vegetables are good for you. The evidence is there. Good detectives don't let some doubt stop them from ever believing anything. Most cases and detectives, when they investigate those cases, they will have some unanswered questions. There will be some things they will never be able to have an answer for. That is just the nature of life. But good detectives don't entertain unreasonable conspiracy theories. They stick with solid evidence. So let's talk about, could the disciples have all conspired to just tell this story about Jesus rising from the dead, even though they knew it really never happened? What would we need for a really good conspiracy? Well, let me stop for a moment. At the beginning of the service today, someone came up here and said that they had taken my cowboy hat. I'm wearing my cowboy hat. I've been wearing my cowboy hat all morning. And they said they had stolen it. They told you they would give you some cookies at the end of service if you kept their secret. Obviously, they didn't tell you the truth. As a matter of fact, I talked to that person before the service and told them to say all of that to you. Here's the thing. I'm going to tell you this, and let me step back in for a second. They do not have any cookies to give you, but I do. I've got an entire package of Oreos here, and here's what I'm going to do. If you are under fifth grade, the first kid to come to the bottom of the stairs gets the entire package of Oreos for their car. If you will tell me who it was. Nice. All right, who was it? Who told you to keep it a secret?
It was Mr. Nate.
Yes, Mr. Nate. The package of Oreos is the package of Oreos is yours. See, here's the thing. You were asked to be part of a conspiracy this morning. You were asked to keep it quiet that my hat was stolen. But what we found out is the conspiracy was a lie. What you were told to do wasn't true. And a bunch of you decided, I'll break that conspiracy if somebody gives me something. I saw several of you start to make a run. Man, I will break the conspiracy because I know the conspiracy's a lie. He's got his hat on and he's offering me cookies. I'll take that one. See, conspiracies based on a lie are really hard to pull off. Someone always talks. Someone always breaks the conspiracy. To make a conspiracy work that is based on a lie, you need five things. Number one is this. You need a very small number of conspirators. Now, I ran the risk this morning that I would do this and no one would break the conspiracy. But I knew with the amount of kids that are going to be here, somebody was going to break it. There was really not much doubt with this many people. Maybe if just two people were asked to keep a secret, you might be able to do it. But if I'm going to ask 50 of you to do it, no chance. The more people you need for the conspiracy, the harder it is to pull it off. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 3 through 8. Here's what we read. I passed on to you what was most important and what had also been passed on to me. Christ died for our sins, just as the scripture said. He was buried and he was raised from the dead on the third day, just as the scripture said. He was seen by Peter and then by the 12. After that, he was seen by more than 500 of his followers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he was seen by James and later by all the apostles. Last of all, as though I had been born at the wrong time, I also saw him. See, we know there were at least 500 witnesses that said they had seen Jesus rise from the dead. 500 at least. And all of them would have had to know that was a lie, and all of them would have had to keep it silent. But we know we have absolutely not a single record of any of them ever changing their testimony. None of them. Doesn't seem like a conspiracy could happen. Here's the second thing that all good conspiracies need. The conspirators have to have great communication. Maybe if all of you kids could have talked it over, maybe you could have kept everybody quiet. Maybe. But without being able to talk to each other, you don't know who's going to break it. You don't know who's going to start making a run. And so what started to happen, even watching you, some of you started looking around to see, is anybody else going? Is that person going? Who's going to break? See, Jesus' followers were scattered all over the Roman Empire. They didn't have telephones or any other way to communicate with each other, not knowing if the other disciples had changed their accounts. Yet they all said what they had witnessed and written about Jesus was true. None of them changed their account, even when they knew maybe somebody else was breaking it. But they told the truth. They never changed. So you need to have good communication if you're going to keep a conspiracy going. Conspiracies also work best for a very short period of time. You guys lasted about what? What did it take for somebody to come running? 4 seconds? All right, about 4 seconds and that conspiracy fell apart. The longer you have to keep a lie, the harder it becomes to do it. The witnesses to Jesus kept their testimonies unchanged for 60 plus years. 60 plus years. That's not how conspiracies work. Conspiracies also work best among really close friends because they don't want to betray the other people. So if you're going to do a conspiracy based on a lie, you better have very close friends that can put pressure on each other not to talk. We know many of the disciples only knew each other for about 3 years. And we can see in the Bible, some of the disciples did not get along real well. You also had 500 plus other people who would not have even known each other. They would have had to keep the lie. But we know that none of them ever changed their testimony. It doesn't sound like a conspiracy. Finally, we know conspiracies need low pressure if you're going to keep your lie. I broke your conspiracy by just offering you some cookies. That was all the pressure I had to put on you, and that was enough to get some of you to break and say, yeah, I'll tell you what really happened. The disciples faced a lot more pressure than somebody offering them cookies. If they were going to keep a lie, they did it even to the point of death. Let me tell you what tradition says happened to the disciples. Andrew, Peter, and Philip were all crucified, and they didn't change their testimonies. Bartholomew was whipped to death. Can you imagine that? And he didn't change his testimony. James the Just was thrown off the temple and then beaten to death by the crowd. He did not change his testimony. The other James was beheaded. He did not change his testimony. Luke was hanged. He did not change his testimony. Mark was tied behind a horse and they dragged him around until he died. And he didn't change his testimony. Matthew was killed by a sword and didn't change his testimony. Matthias was stoned and then he was beheaded and he did not change his testimony. Thomas was stabbed to death with a spear, did not change his testimony. Those executions took place from Jerusalem, Greece, India, and Rome. They couldn't communicate with each other. They weren't necessarily close friends. They were offered their lives if they would just give up the lie. And all of them said, no, because it's not a lie. It's true. With all that pressure and not knowing what the others said, not a one changed their account or turned on their belief in Jesus. Now, some people will say this, well, there are Muslims and Hindus and Mormons who have died for their faith. That doesn't mean they died. What they died for was true. Just because you'll die for it doesn't mean it's true. Well, modern-day martyrs, people who die for what they believe, they will die for something they believe is true. There are some people who will die for something that they believe is true. But the disciples, if they were carrying out a conspiracy, they didn't die for something they believe is true. They died for something they knew was a lie. People do not die for lies. They don't do it. See, all these different things make it unreasonable to think that what we know about Jesus was just a conspiracy. It was a lie pushed by his followers. It doesn't make sense. It's not reasonable to believe. So, with all the detective skills you now have, you can believe that it is reasonable that there is a God, that the Bible is accurate and it's trustworthy, and that Jesus is who he claimed to be. But that is not enough. Believing these things are true is not what God desires of you. He doesn't desire for you just to believe that it's true. Take a look at John 3:16. Honk when you get it, or honk if you have it memorized. One of the most famous verses in Scripture. Here's what it says. For this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only Son so that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. See, Jesus doesn't say that it's those that believe that he is who he said he is get eternal life. He says it's those who believe in him that will have eternal life. There is a difference between belief that and belief in. Detective Wallace, who wrote the book Cold Case Christianity, he tells the story of a police officer named Mark. Mark got shot, and here's how it happened. He had pulled over a man who was speeding. They found out later that the man he was pulling over was a wanted convict. And when the man was pulled over, the officer walked up, asked him to get out of the car. And when the man got out of the car, he pulled a gun on Officer Mark. Mark said, I knew I was not going to beat him to the draw. He already had his gun out. And he said, I know I was going to get shot. And I went for my gun anyway. And people said, why? If you knew you weren't going to get off the first shot, why'd you go for your gun anyway? And he said, because I was wearing a bulletproof vest. I had trained with the vest. I had seen the vest take bullets. And I believed that the vest could stop a bullet. But now I was going to have to believe in the vest. I was going to have to trust it with my life. Not just know it could do it. I was going to have to act believing in it. And so here's what Mark said, quote, I just tensed my stomach muscles and prepared to take the shot as I pulled my gun out of the holster. I knew he was going to get the first round off. Mark survived the encounter and the suspect was apprehended. See, that night, Mark moved from belief that the vest would stop a bullet and to belief in the vest and that it would stop a bullet. And that's what Jesus asked of us. It's not enough to believe that he was who he said he was. You must move beyond and place your belief directly in him. You must put your life in his hands. Act on what you know. Obey his commands. Live the life that he has for you. And when you do it, when you go from believing that to placing your belief in him, now you receive eternal life. Now you receive forgiveness of sin. Now you receive a right relationship with God. If you have not believed that there is a God, that the Bible is trustworthy and accurate, that Jesus is who he said he is, I would love to have that discussion with you. If you don't believe that yet, I'd love to have that discussion. Come see me after the service, send me an email, give me a phone call. I was going to say, let's go out to eat. All right? But if you don't believe that, let's talk about the evidence. But if you already believe that, then I pray that you'll now put your belief in Jesus. That you will do more than just intellectually accept it. You will begin to trust him with your life, to be baptized, to begin living the life he desires of you. You can do that today. Honk your horn if somebody in your vehicle has been baptized. Honk your horn. Honk your horn if somebody in your vehicle has not been baptized. Okay? See, we have people that have placed their belief in, and we have people that have not placed their belief in. You can do that today. We've baptized people in our hot tub. We can get the baptistry out today. We want to encourage you. Don't just believe that. Use good detective skills to figure out that it's true. But then move beyond that to placing your faith in Jesus. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the evidence that points us to you, the evidence that leads us to believe that there is a God, that your word is trustworthy and accurate, that Jesus is exactly who he says he is. But Lord, I pray that we do not stop there, that we place our faith in you, and that we truly begin obeying you and living the lives that you would have us lead. And as we do that, that we find that we have eternal life, that our sins are forgiven, that we find that we are now right with you. We thank you for your gift of grace. We thank you for the evidence you've left for us. We thank you for the skills that you help us develop so that we can learn all about you and who you are. But we thank you even more that you give us new life, and that you accept us into your family, that you show us grace, and that you pay the price for our sins. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you haven't taken that step, I want to encourage you. We would love to talk to you today and get that worked out. Is there anyone here that's been baptized in our hot tub? We had a couple first service, so yeah. So if that's something you want to do, we can get it done today. At this time, we are going to get ready for our time of offering and communion. You can come up here, and there's some plates up here if you want to give. There's also our communion. We encourage you to send one person up for your vehicle to grab communion. You can also begin putting orders in over at the food truck if you're going to stay for lunch. And Monica's got some announcements as we continue on and we do that. So you can come up and get your communion.
Good morning, church. There is something about eating some good food and listening to Barry at the same time. It is that food smelt good when it was coming in, and I smelt the truck. I was like, whoo, I'm so excited for that. So anyway, got our food. So if you haven't gotten your food, like Barry said, you're welcome to do communion, and then go ahead and get in line to get your food this morning. And they are here a little bit earlier so that the lines aren't as long, and so you're welcome to do that. First of all, first service, I talked a little bit and had a prayer request. We have one of our very own, Kelly R. I'm not going to butcher her last name right now.
Right.
But no, I'm not saying it. And she is in the hospital right now, and she has had just a go of it, right, the last 30 to 45 days, and it has just been one thing after another for her, and our hearts have been broken for her. And so we've saw prayer request after prayer request, and some good news would come, and then we'd have to have another prayer request. And so she is currently in the hospital right now. So I told first service we were going to do a Zoom meeting, and that we were going to be doing that meeting at 2 o'clock today, and that I would send all that information out. And between the end of first service and the middle of this service, I got a message from Kelly saying, hey, can we do that Zoom another time because they're letting me go home? And not only are they letting her go home, but I want to tell you that when she went into the hospital, when they first did some blood work, her white blood cell count was 23,000. Her white blood count when she went to get that test done this morning, 3,300. God is good. He is good. And so we're excited for that. And so if you would just continue to pray for her, she is still, and we are asking God for a complete healing in her body right now. And so if you know Kelly, she is our women's ministry MO. And so if you are, even if you don't know her, just to pray for her. And then we will, during the week, this week, do a Zoom meeting with Kelly. And she will, and so you'll be welcome to join that. But it won't be today because she's not sure exactly when she's going to be leaving the hospital and all the checkout process. So just continue to pray for her. We are so excited for that news. We have a couple of announcements in regards. We have really been trying to plan activities, do some stuff online. And so we have a couple of things that we have going on this week. The first one is I have gone this weekend and I planned an entire scavenger hunt in our park. And it's from the tree line that's closest to us all the way to the tree line that's on the other side of the park. And so on Monday, tomorrow, we will be sending out a push notification and on our Facebook page that'll tell you all the items that I have hidden over in the park for your family. And so we encourage you to take some time. The weather is going to be beautiful this week. I've seen 75 predicted and maybe even higher this week. And so go out with your family and just take some time at our park and just walk around. The things aren't in places where, well, It'll be good. I think some middle schoolers could find some joy. I'm telling Barry and Beth Ann to go out and bring Frankie out there and look around as well. And so just come on out and do that this week. Another thing that we have going on is I have started a group called First Cup, and it's a Facebook group. And that group is available to men and women, teens to 100. And what that time is at 7 a.m. every day, Monday through Friday, I will be posting something in there. Sometimes it'll be a live. Sometimes it'll be something that's pre-recorded. Sometimes it's just a thought for the day. Maybe it's write down some things that you're grateful for this week and post those in the comment box. If you need a prayer, or you are able to answer some prayers, we asked you to comment in that group as well. And so we have about 50 that have come and joined that group so far already. And we've got some prayer requests that have already been put in there. And so we just ask that if you haven't joined that, to join us for that. That's just another way. And we will actually continue to have that group even when we're in our building and all of this stuff is in our past. And so go and join that. And I hope you find some encouragement there as well. And finally, we have a silver box up here, and this box has a notebook and pen there, and that is a place where if you have a prayer, if you have a need that you need some help meeting, or if you are able to meet a need for somebody, we'd ask that you would put that in there. So an example of a need you might be able to help with is if we have people that are up in age or have a pre-existing condition that aren't able or don't feel comfortable going into the grocery stores, maybe you would be willing to meet that need by going grocery shopping for them. We are looking for people that might be willing to go in and maybe for a family do a small devotion. We've got some families that both parents are working, and even though they're working from home, they've got preschoolers, and it's tough. It's tough. And we've got mamas that are just needing some time. Whether you could take their babies for a half an hour or 3 hours or whatever that is of going, it's tough. They're trying to work and keep their house quiet. It's not just the working and having kids. It's working and trying to be on the phone and have conversations with people while keeping a two-year-old quiet. And that's a lot of work. And these mamas are stressed and they need someone to just come in and maybe come on their property or to their house and draw chalk on their in their driveway. And so if that's something that you're able to help with or you would be willing to do, I can let you know that there's people right now in this service that would take you up on that. So if you are able to do that, come see me or put it in the box, and that will get to Melanie, and Melanie will be able to get that and send out those needs for everyone. I think that's it. So thank you so much for your time.
Kids, for our kids, we have some stuff up here. We're sending cards out to our assisted living facilities. You can imagine they're having a really hard time with all this. They're isolated. And so we want to let some of our older folks know that we are praying for them and that they are not alone. And so kids have been doing cards for them. You can come up here and put those in that clear bucket up here. We'll make sure those get sent out. If you want to do some of those, you can pick some of those up here. Also, we have thankful chain packets for the kids this week. And so if you want something for your kids to do, they can pick that up at the picnic table. There are also K through 5th lessons going on online during the week. And so I want to help you keep your kids connected to what's going on at the church, and I also put some extra Oreos up here. So for those of you who didn't get Oreos, you can get those after the service, all right? So I want to thank you as we move into our time of communion. Want to thank you for your giving during this time too. We've been able to continue to meet our bills, and we've been able to make sure that we're meeting the needs of the missionaries we support and all. And so I want to thank you for that. If you did not hear, I posted on Facebook this week, there was a fire in the Honduran open market in Tegucigalpa where our mission that we support is, over, I think it was 400 of their little booths got burned down. And that is individual families and people. That is the means they support themselves. So you can imagine with all that's going on, didn't I have a fire burn down your business? Has just been terrible down there. And so we are going to be trying to see what we can do to help them out. If we have extra, we'll be trying to send some extra down to them. And so we thank you for your giving, and we ask that you keep them in your prayers. And we'll bring updates to that and how we can help on a regular basis to you. For I pass on to you what I received from the Lord himself. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took some bread and gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it in pieces and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. Do this in remembrance of me as often as you drink it." For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes again. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this memorial dinner that you've given us, that even in tough times, we know that Christians all around the world are continuing to remember what you've done for us. We pray that through this time, we will be able to proclaim to our neighbors and our friends and our coworkers and those around us that you have died for us, that we are forgiven, that we have a new family, that we look forward to being in a home where there is no tears and no pain and no suffering, and when we will be with you face to face, and we will all eat together in your kingdom. We thank you for your church. We thank you for the people that are here today, for those who are online. We thank you for the resources you've given us to be able to help others. I pray for those in Honduras right now that are really struggling with all this. I pray that for those of us who have been given much, that will overflow in generosity for our Christian brothers and sisters. I pray that you give us opportunities to meet each other's needs, to be your hands and your feet and your voice to those who are hurting and suffering. We just thank you for all you do for us. I pray us in Jesus' name. Amen. We've got the food truck here, so if you want to stay for lunch, we are going to do some things differently next week. As some of the restrictions are lifted, next week we are going to set up chairs up here in front, so if you would like to worship together, sitting out here together, we're going to be doing that. If you wish to still stay in your cars during that time, that is fine. If you want to bring some lawn chairs, but we will start trying to keep with the standards that are being set. We're going to continue to try to loosen that some and allow for some of that. We thank you for coming out this morning. Thank you for watching us online. We will see you throughout the week. Go and be the church, everyone. Thank you.
Found.